Guten Abend, sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, sehr geehrter Professor Rosenblum, sehr geehrter Herr Grummet, liebe Zuschauer und Zuschauerinnen zu Hause an Ihren Bildschirmen. Ein sehr herzliches Willkommen.
A very warm welcome to the virtual space of the Michael Blumenthal Academy of the Berlin Jewish Museum. In our dialogue lecture series, Kosher to Go, we explore different ways of looking at religious food or drinking rules. Where did these laws originate? How did they evolve over time? These are the questions we are addressing. And did religious and cultural communities possibly influence each other in terms of their culinary as well as cultic traditions? So these are the questions we focus on in our lecture series, and each time we invite two scholars with different perspectives to speak on a particular topic. So our first lecture focused on the general question, well, why do dietary rules exist at all? The second one was about animal slaughter in Judaism and Islam. And we are happy to say that you can watch these lectures afterwards on our museum page. In our upcoming events, we will look at the relationship to animals in Judaism and Hinduism, and in the end, we will be looking at religious dietary rules in relation to ecology and modern debates about food in ours. Tim, kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for your love is better than wine. Well, this sentence comes from the Song of Songs in the Old Testament, Tanakh. And it gives us an idea of how much symbolism was attached to wine, even in biblical times. Well, the beverage is described in a very romantic context in the Song of Songs. However, there are strict rules on how to use wine and interpretations about its meaning. So to learn more about it, we have invited two experts whom I would like to introduce to you now. Jordan D. Rosenblum is a professor of Jewish studies at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. He's the author of The Jewish Dietary Laws in the Ancient World, published by Cambridge University Press in 2016. Among his most recent publications, we find his book on rabbinic drinking, What Beverages Teach Us About Rabbinic Literature, published by University of California Press in 2020. David Grummet is senior lecturer in theology and ethics at the University of Edinburgh. He has published widely on Eucharist and the theological view of food. His most important publication is Material Eucharist, published by Oxford University Press in 2016, where he traces, based on insights from history, anthropology, archaeology, and cultural studies, the history of the Eucharist in its material forms of bread and wine. Before we begin with the presentations by our guests, let me make some technical remarks to all our viewers. The event will be held in German and English, and there will be simultaneous translation. After the two lectures, we will move on to our panel discussion. So you will have the opportunity to raise your questions in German or English language via Slido. And you can find the Slido link for this event on our homepage. Or you can go directly to the www.slido.com website. You can also download the free Slido app via your app store. And the event code is hashtag
658015.
So rest assured, though, that we will repeat this information during the live stream. So, Professor Rosenblum, the stage, or rather the screen, is yours now. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you to the museum for inviting me, to you for hosting, And to the translator for translating, I wish I had this when I studied German in graduate school. So without further ado, I will begin my talk. So the first appearance of wine in the Hebrew Bible covers the full range of both possibilities for celebration and danger. After surviving the flood aboard an ark full of animals, Noah departs his ark with three sons. We are then told, and I'll have the on the screen, there will be the text that I'm quoting throughout the talk. Noah, the tiller of soil, was the first to plant a vineyard. He drank from the wine and became intoxicated, and he uncovered himself within his tent. Planting a vineyard allows you to grow grapes and to enjoy a celebratory glass of wine, but drinking too much wine and you lose inhibition and you act in ways that might have serious social, economic, and theological repercussions. The ancient rabbis inherit and innovate on the full range of wine's possibilities. The ancient rabbis lived in the first through seventh centuries of the Common Era. Interestingly and importantly, as we shall see, the rabbis do not outright ban wine. They are aware that wine can be drunk to excess, and that wine might lead to various theological, social, and sexual transgressions, but they never completely declare wine verboten. In fact, they ritually distinguish wine as especially important. They do so by mandating that a special rabbinic blessing is recited before drinking wine. As Mishnah Brachot 6:1 states, how does one recite a blessing for fruit? For fruit of the tree, one says, creator of the fruit of the tree, except for wine. For upon wine, one says, creator of the fruit of the vine. When consuming any whole fruit, whether apple or grape, the same blessing would be recited, creator of the fruit of the tree, or in Hebrew, berei pri haetz. When that fruit is squeezed into juice, a generic blessing is recited, by whose word everything came into being, in Hebrew, she'akol nehiye bedvaro. However, while that generic blessing, juice blessing, would work for every other fruit, juice, the grape is exceptional. Once a grape is turned into wine, then a unique blessing must be recited, creator of the fruit of the vine, in Hebrew, berei pri hagefen. The rabbis therefore use liturgical formulae to attach great importance to wine. Though wine is clearly marked as important, wine also raises a whole host of concerns. In fact, while meat and kosher animal slaughter, in Hebrew shchita, are the subject of much discussion, including, as Shlomit mentioned, an earlier talk in this series, the relevant kosher laws, in Hebrew kashrut, regarding wine receive just as much, if not more, rabbinic attention. It is perhaps also worthy of note here that, unlike wine, meat has no unique blessing that one must recite over it. Instead, the generic rabbinic blessing is recited, by whose word everything came into being. This is the same blessing, as I noted a minute ago, recited over fruit juice. It also covers a variety of other foodstuffs, from ice cream and chocolate to non-wine alcohols such as beer and scotch. So why are the rabbis so worried about wine? Because they believe that their contemporaneous Gentiles were idol worshippers who possessed an insatiable urge to pour out wine as a ritual libation to their many deities. And since Rabbinic Judaism considers idol worship to be the polar opposite of its monotheistic worship, they devote significant attention to avoiding idolatrous practice. Wine is often used to symbolize these forbidden practices and the ways to avoid them. In fact, the tractate of the Mishnah and the Talmud that centers on the topic of idolatry, in Hebrew, avodah zarah, which literally means foreign worship, closes with an extended discussion of social relations with idolaters during the production, storage, and consumption of wine. Yet we must note that wine is neither completely banned, nor is drinking wine with a non-Jew. However, the entire process from the beginning of production to the transport, storage, and eventual consumption of wine is heavily regulated. At the core of these regulations is the central belief that non-Jews are, in the words of scholar Sasha Stern, compulsive libationers who cannot resist the urge to pour wine to their deity. And since once wine is libated, it is classified rabbinically as libated wine, or in Hebrew, yein nesech, with an associated series of complicated prohibitions, then this means that any interaction between Jew and non-Jews that involves wine, even if the wine is produced by Jews, must be heavily monitored. A representative example of this social surveillance appears in Mishnah Avodah Zarah, chapter 5, sections 4 to 5, which states, if a Jew left a non-Jew alone and unsupervised in his store, even though he goes in and out, the wine in the Jew store is permitted. But if the Jew informed the non-Jew that he was departing, then the wine is prohibited if there was enough time to bore a hole in the wine barrel, stop it up, and for the clay to dry. Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel says, if there was enough time to open it and close it and for it to dry. If a Jew was eating with a non-Jew at the same table, and the Jew left a bottle of wine on the table and a bottle on the side table, and left the non-Jew alone and unsupervised, and then went out, what is on the table is prohibited, and that which is on the side table is permitted. But if he said to the non-Jew, mix wine with water for yourself and drink, then even that which is on the side table is prohibited. Wine in open jugs is prohibited. Sealed wine jugs are prohibited if there was enough time to open it up and to close it up and for it to dry. In this scenario, which in the words of scholar Peter Schaefer resembles a cops and robbers game, Jews must remain eternally vigilant when leaving non-Jews alone with wine, because non-Jews are imagined as unable to resist the urge to libate wine, even going to the comical extreme of boring holes in wine barrels and then resealing them in order to hide their idolatrous actions. Such wine is presumed to be prohibited. Therefore, even if the wine was not actually libated, and therefore is not officially yein nesech, right, that Hebrew term for libated wine, it is prohibited simply because it has been left unguarded and potentially handled by a non-Jew. The Hebrew term for this category of prohibition is stam yeinam, which is employed with, there is a workaround for this, which involves boiling the wine, in Hebrew yayin mevushal, which is employed with many kosher wines today, and I'm happy to discuss this, the complicated rules associated with that during the question and answer period. Given concern for libated wine, one might imagine that if wine were not completely banned, at least drinking wine with Jews would, non-Jews would be, but a strategic accommodation is created. Jews and non-Jews may drink wine together, but non-Jews are not to be trusted around Jewish wine without Jewish supervision. Let's see. While the wine of, or the wine left alone with, a non-Jew is suspected out of concern for libation, what about non-wine intoxicants? Since the rabbis are aware that wine was the only beverage libated by idolaters, do the same stigmas attach to other beverages that, while still alcohol, are not subject to idolatrous libation? This question is especially important for the rabbinic community that resides in Babylonia, where beer and not wine is the beverage of choice. Since beer is not libated in idolatrous rituals, it is kosher to drink, provided that a Jew leaves the non-Jew's bar first. Thus we learn, it was stated, why did they prohibit the beer of idolaters? Rami Bar Chama said in the name of Rabbi Yitzchak, because of intermarriage. For Rav Papa, they would bring the beer out of the door of the non-Jew's tavern, and he would drink it there. For Rav Achai, they would bring it to his house, and he would drink it there. Both of them agreed that the prohibition existed in order to prevent intermarriage. But Rav Achai made a greater buffer. Non-wine intoxicants prepared by idolaters are not libated. Beer can never be libated wine, can never be yein nesech. Why then do the rabbis express concern about the beer of idolaters? Because the rabbis are aware that drinking together can lead to romance. That is, that social intercourse, is the first step down the slippery slope that leads to sexual intercourse. And the romance need not be between the two drinkers themselves. So for example, imagine the scenario described in another rabbinic text. Two men were drinking wine under the willows in Babylonia. One took a wine cup, handed it to his friend and said, betroth for me your daughter to my son. Drinking buddies might want their children to be married, so be wary with whom you drink. Returning to the text, the non-wine alcohol of an idolater is not subject to the libation prohibition. It is neither yein nesach or stam yeinam, and therefore cannot be banned in and of itself. Instead, it is the social situation and not the beverage that is deemed non-kosher. Thus, the two rabbis are described as ordering Gentile beer but drinking it off-premises. In the case of Rav Papa, himself a renowned brewer who built a fortune by brewing craft beers, he would drink non-Jewish beer as soon as he walked outside of the non-Jewish bar. Rav Achai, on the other hand, was more stringent, and he would not drink non-Jewish beer until he was safely within the confines of his own home. Both rabbis agreed that the beer itself was kosher, but the social situation was not. They simply disagreed by how much physical distance one must place between themselves and the non-Jewish bar. And I'm happy to talk about this in question and answer, but I don't think it's coincidental that Rav Papa, who makes a lot of money off of beer, has the most lenient opinion about how you can drink beer. I think it's good for the beer industry. So, while there is much more that I could discuss regarding idolatry and rabbinic wine regulations, which I'm happy to expand upon in the question and answer period, I devote the rest of my allotted time to some fascinating other intersections between alcohol and rabbinic rituals. But first, some background information is needed. The ancient rabbinic community had two main centers, one in Roman Palestine, which is roughly modern-day Israel, and the other in Sasanian Babylonia, which is roughly modern-day Iraq. There were various similarities and differences between these two communities, and one key difference is that the rabbis in Roman Palestine were wine drinkers, and the rabbis in Sasanian Babylon were beer drinkers. The rabbis in Sasanian Babylon inherited many earlier texts from rabbinic communities in Roman Palestine, most notably the Mishnah. And several rituals in these texts from Roman Palestine feature wine. For example, the Sabbath, which occurs weekly from sundown Friday night to sundown on Saturday night, is bookended by two wine-based rituals. At the beginning of Sabbath, on Friday night, there's a blessing over wine, known in Hebrew as kiddush, meaning declare holy or sanctification. And the liturgy for the conclusion of the Sabbath on Saturday night, in Hebrew havdalah, literally meaning separation or division, also prominently features wine. But can one substitute beer for wine when conducting these rituals? We begin, as rabbinic conversation so often does, with an anecdote. Mar Yanuka and Bar Kashisha, the sons of Rav Chisda, said to Rav Ashi, "One time, a Maimar visited our place on Saturday afternoon, and we did not have wine with which to recite Havdalah, that end of Sabbath ritual. We brought him beer, but he did not recite Havdalah using the beer, and spent the night fasting." That's a quote from the book of Daniel 6:19. "The next day we took the trouble and brought him wine, and he recited Havdalah using the wine and ate something. The following year he again visited our place. Once again we did not have wine. We brought beer again to him, and he said, 'If so, beer is the wine of the region.' Therefore he recited Havdalah using the beer, and he ate something." Since there's so much to discuss, I'm going to pause the Talmudic passage here. The story begins when a Maimar visited Rav Chisda's son on a Sabbath afternoon. As evening approached, they prepared to recite Havdalah, a ritual that separates, in the words of the ritual itself, between holy and profane, between light and darkness, between Israel and the nations, between the seventh day and the 6 days of labor. At this moment, a problem arose. The brothers had no wine. A Maimar refused to recite Havdalah using beer. In addition, he did not eat because the conversation earlier in this text of the Talmud related to whether one may eat prior to reciting Havdalah. Therefore, he went to bed hungry, having been unable to recite Havdalah. When he woke up on Sunday morning, the brothers, who themselves had recited Havdalah using their beer, found wine so that their visitor could recite Havdalah and eat. The next year, perhaps forgetting his previous experience, he visits his wineless friends, and the situation repeats itself. But now, a Maimar realizes that the brothers must live in a region like Wisconsin, where I'm reading these words, or Germany, where these words are being heard, where beer is the preferred beverage. It is the wine of the region. In that case, he concludes that it is acceptable, at least in such a location, to recite Havdalah using beer, which is precisely what he does. I pause here because the phrase beer is the wine of the region has an interesting afterlife. In fact, there was a 2016 exhibit at the Jewish Museum of Munich on Jews and beer. And the title of this catalog, which appears in the slide, clearly alludes to this passage. Forgive my German pronunciation, I'll do my best. Bier ist der Wein dieses Landes, jüdischer Braugeschichten. So clearly referring to this passage. So returning to our text, we examine whether a Maimar's Havdalah practice is a general Sabbath ritual principle for all to follow. After briefly discussing other related laws learned from a Maimar's actions, the text continues, Rav Huna inquired of Rav Chisda, what is the law regarding reciting Kiddush using beer? He said, now, if this is the case regarding beer made from figs, dates, or dilman dates, which I inquired of Rav, whether they're suitable for reciting Kiddush, and Rav inquired of Rabbi Chia, and Rabbi Chia inquired of Rabbi, and he could not resolve the legal problem for him, so they couldn't figure out the answer to it. Can there even be a question regard to barley beer? It was understood from this. It is specifically Kiddush that we cannot recite using beer, but we can indeed recite Havdalah using beer. Rav Chisda said to them, thus said Rav, just as one does not recite Kiddush over it, so too one does not recite Havdalah over it. It was also stated, Rav Tachlifa Bar Avimi said, that Shmuel said, just as one does not recite Kiddush over it, so too one does not recite Havdalah over it. So the question arises, can one recite Kiddush using beer? The answer is no. But rather than just say that, the text needs to explain the reasoning. Several authorities investigated whether one could recite Kiddush using beer brewed from superior ingredients. So these are better quality ingredients. And they could not resolve the debate in the affirmative. In short, they could not conclude that one may indeed use the beers for reciting Kiddush. And if they could not do so for these higher quality beers, such as date beer, is there any doubt that a lesser quality beer made from barley could possibly be used for such a ritual purpose? Therefore, beer is off the table with regard to the recitation of Kiddush. But the text at first concludes that we can indeed recite Havdalah using beer. Two different traditions are introduced that state the same ruling verbatim. Beer is unsuitable for the recitation of either Kiddush or Havdalah. But the text does not leave things where they stand. Why? Because there's still support for using Havdalah, using beer for Havdalah. A series of anecdotes are related on Bavli Pesachim 107a, which I do not quote on the slide, so on that same page of the Talmud, but that seek to denigrate the position of beer in regard to Sabbath ritual. One rabbi praises a particular beer, declaring it to be fit to recite Kiddush over, but then walks back that claim after that beer causes him intestinal troubles. In another tale, Rav Huna accuses Rav of reciting Kiddush over beer solely because Rav has begun to profit from the sale of beer, and hence using beer instead of wine for ritual purposes would seem to be designed for his own financial gain. So further, two traditions are cited that claim that Kiddush can only be recited using wine and not beer. However, note that traditions continue to take issue with beer for the recitation of Kiddush, but not Havdalah, so the entry into Sabbath ritual, but not the exit out of. It would seem clear that Sabbath must begin by reciting Kiddush over wine, but possibly could conclude with the recitation of Havdalah using either wine or beer. This topic continued to be debated long after the Talmud was edited, and unfortunately, beer does not always get its proper due. There is much more that we could discuss about the role that alcohol plays in Rabbinic Judaism. As the title of today's lecture implies, there's a lot of territory to cover between sanction and sanctification. And as my colleague who will speak next will explore, there's a rich conversation on this topic outside of Rabbinic Judaism as well. The main point I want to convey is that we should consider alcohol not just as a beverage, but as a means to discuss a variety of rabbinic concepts, from idolatry to Sabbath ritual and beyond. As I argue in my recent book, pictured on the slide, whether we focus on the contents in the glass, how it was poured, with whom it's drunk, alcohol has much to teach us about key themes in rabbinic literature. For now, I will leave you with a drinking toast invoked by the ancient sage Rabbi Akiva. Wine and life to the mouth of the rabbis, life and wine to the mouth of the rabbis and the mouth of their students. Thank you.
Danke, Professor Rosenblum, für Ihren Vortrag.
Thank you very much, Professor Rosenblum, for your lecture. It did help us to get a scientific insight into a Jewish perspective on the subject. And now, of course, we move on directly to Professor Grummet's lecture, who will give us the scientific view on the topic from a Christian perspective. Please, sir, you have the floor.
Well, many thanks indeed to the Academy of the Jewish Museum Berlin for the tremendous privilege of the invitation to speak. I visited the museum during a month in Berlin several years back and recall the deep impression both the building and its exhibits made on me. I'd of course love to be there again in person this evening, though because of the pandemic must regretfully await a return visit in the future. I'll begin tonight by tracing Christian use of wine in worship to the Last Supper and the Passover meal. The wine was identified with Christ's blood shed on the cross, encouraged by Tanakh imagery of the vine and the winepress. I'll then address why both bread and wine are needed as vehicles for Christ's presence and explain different theories of this presence. In the final part, I'll look at the geographical and economic impacts of Christian wine usage, especially monastic vineyards and distillation, and examine contrasting moral evaluations by Christians of alcohol consumption. For many decades, Christian liturgists have traced the origins of the Eucharist to the Passover meal, which, as is well known, uses wine. In all four Gospel accounts, wine features as part of the Last Supper. Jesus eats this supper with his closest followers on Maundy Thursday, and the Christian Eucharist is modelled on it. In both Matthew and Mark, a cup of wine is shared sometime after the sharing of bread. Jesus takes the cup, gives thanks, and instructs the diners to share it. The first letter to the Corinthians, written by the Apostle Paul to the church in Corinth, places the sharing of the cup potentially later, after supper. For associating the Last Supper with the Passover meal, however, Luke's account is the most instructive because it includes two wine cups. Jesus opens the meal by taking a cup of wine, giving thanks, and inviting those present to share the cup. After the meal, Jesus again takes a cup of wine, identifying it as the new covenant in his blood, and gives it to those present. Jesus' identification of the wine with his blood foreshadows his death and is encouraged by two pieces of Tanakh imagery. The first is the shoot coming forth from the stock or stem of Jesse in Isaiah 1:11, which Christians have interpreted genealogically to identify Jesus' ancestry in the father of David. The stock has frequently been understood as a vine, including in medieval art, with the many generations of patriarchs, prophets, and other figures leading down to Jesus depicted hanging from its long branch. The image is taken up in John's Gospel. Christ is the true vine and his father is the vine dresser. Other interpreters have compared Jesus on the cross with a cluster of grapes on a vine, encouraged by a typological reading of the two Israelite scouts carrying the huge cluster hung on a pole between them back from Canaan in Numbers 13. The second piece of Tanakh imagery, appropriated by medieval Christian theologians and artists, is the treader of the winepress. In Isaiah 63, the prophet asks, "Who is this that comes from Edom, from Bozrah in garment stained crimson? Who is this so splendidly robed, marching in his great might?" The approaching figure then announces himself, "It is I, announcing vindication, mighty to save." In response, Isaiah inquires, "Why are your robes red and your garments like those who tread the winepress?" The figure answers, "I have trodden the winepress alone, and from the peoples no one was with me. I trod them in my anger and trampled them in my wrath. Their juice spattered on my garments and stained all my robes." When applied to Jesus, the exchange in Isaiah could be taken as triumphal. Jesus rises from the dead, tramples down death, and bestows life upon those lying entombed. However, in other traditions, the winepress imagery suggests sacrifice, with the winepress imaging the cross, not least because both include wood and iron. This is reinforced by Augustine's typology of Noah and Christ. After the flood, Noah, who is described in Genesis as the first plant of vineyard, became drunk and was seen naked by his son Ham, whereas Christ, who planted the vineyard of Israel, was also exposed naked on the cross. On this reading, Christ, in his sacrifice for death and sin, offers the wine that flows from his crushed and pierced body to give new life to the world. So much then for the scriptural grounding of a Christian theological view of wine. I began by discussing the origins of the Last Supper in the Passover meal, but will now say more about the Christian development of Eucharistic theology and practice. At least two questions are important. First, why are there two Eucharistic elements, wine and bread? As is well known, the Passover meal includes a range of foodstuffs to which the New Testament accounts make no explicit reference. From the references to a meal, it seems that items other than wine and bread were also consumed. But as the Christian Eucharist developed, it came to be that only wine and bread were used. These two elements came to signify the separation of Christ's blood from his body at his passion and death. A single element, whether wine or bread, would have symbolised less powerfully the sacrificial pouring out of Jesus' life. A second theological question, which follows from this, concerns how Jesus is understood to be present in the Eucharist in the elements of bread and wine. Views of this differ widely between Christian denominations. In some, the bread and wine are viewed as unchanged and as identical to bread and wine ordinarily consumed. In other denominations, they're believed to be changed in some way, so that Jesus becomes physically or spiritually present in them. In denominations where this is believed, the question about why two elements are necessary may well arise. Indeed, at Roman Catholic Mass, the people frequently only receive the bread. After all, it might be argued, if they've already received the substance of Christ's body as bread, receiving the wine afterwards would add nothing. However, a possibility that's standardly overlooked in modern debates is that Jesus may be differently present as wine than as bread. In the accounts of Matthew and Mark, the bread is blessed before being taken and eaten by the diners. However, in all accounts of the Last Supper, the wine is shared without first being blessed. This may have inspired some medieval Christian theologians to distinguish Jesus' mode of presence in the bread from his mode of presence in the wine. The issues at stake were played out in the late medieval controversy between Franciscan and Dominican theologians over the theological status of Jesus' exsanguinated blood. Both groups accepted that when Jesus died, his body remained joined to his divinity. They differed, however, on the status of his blood when he died. For Dominicans, Christ's blood was part of the truth of his humanity and was therefore reassumed to his divinity at the resurrection. There can be no humanity without blood, the Dominican theologians argued. According to contemporary physiology, it was indeed uterine blood out of which the human body was created in the womb. Franciscans like John Capistrano, in contrast, taught that the blood shed in the Passion remained in the world of nature and so was separated from Christ's resurrection body. Following this reasoning, the contents of the chalice have no special status. The separation of Christ's blood from his body, which the chalice signifies, was primarily, on this view, a sign of his death, and thereby of the price he paid for human sin. The Franciscan view suggests that, in participating in Christ's resurrection body, the reception of the chalice has a purely negative value, figuring an absence rather than a presence. In any case, Christian liturgical usage of wine has contributed through history to a close association between monasteries and vineyards. This has shaped the landscape. St. Martin developed vineyards in the Loire Valley around Tours, which produced the wine today known as Touraine. Benedictine nuns and Irish missionaries planted vines in Franconia. Jesuits and Franciscan friars developed the viticulture of California. Monks established vineyards in regions that no longer produce wine, such as Prussia, Thuringia, Ireland, and swathes of England. Monasteries also became invested in distillation, the process by which wine is made stronger, with spirits like Chartreuse and Benedictine now famous across the world. In the medieval and early modern periods, alcoholic spirits were produced in tiny quantities, primarily for medical purposes. The transformation that distillation produced was viewed as eucharistic, being compared with the change that the bread and wine underwent at their consecration. Knowledge of how to distill alcohol was highly prized, with instructions sometimes written in code. Spirits were believed to prolong and enhance human life, improve character, foresight and wisdom, purify the body by balancing its humours, increase the powers of cognition and perception, cure innumerable specified illnesses, and offer protection during disease pandemics. The distillation of liquids was sometimes understood in the terms of Jesus' passion. The physical construction of the alembic, with a gourd-shaped still pot known as a cucurbit, connected by a cap at its narrow end to a tube sloping diagonally downward to a receiver, was suggestive of the cross. Arnold of Villanova, affirming that it is proper that the Son of Man be exalted into the air from the earth by the cross, provides imagery for Christ's crucifixion, death and resurrection. John of Rupecissa writes of the cucurbit that whatever ascends from there is pure and spiritual and converted into air and exalted in the cross of the head of the alembic just like Christ. Furthermore, the use of red wine, which following the application of heat to the cucurbit was condensed into droplets of distillate that were collected in the receiver, was suggestive of Christ's blood shed on the cross, and especially of the miraculous flow of blood from his body following his death, when his side was pierced by the spear of Longinus. Moreover, in some accounts and visual depictions, this blood was collected by angels, apostles, or saints in one or more vessels. In any case, by fashioning something new and perfect out of corruptible matter, the distiller anticipated a new creation, bringing heaven to earth and thereby inaugurating the last days described in the Book of Revelation. The fascinating and much neglected topic of distillation in Christian theology unfortunately can't be further pursued here. Yet it brings us back to the topic of wine and Christian theology because it is due to the social problems resulting from mass distillation that the modern Christian abstention and prohibition movements arose. In all New Testament accounts, the wine shared at the Last Supper is referred to indirectly as the fruit of the vine. This has enabled abstentionists to contend that the wine was in fact antithetical to Christian faith and morals, and that was what was shared at the Last Supper was in fact non-alcoholic grape juice. On this basis, some individuals and churches in countries including Britain and the United States have avoided alcohol and have in some cases sought to have its sale or consumption outlawed. Drawing on the censure of drunkenness in several New Testament letters and on advice against even moderate wine drinking if this brought harmful social consequences, biblically based preaching and pastoral support provided temperance movements with an important theological dimension. By the late 19th century, it seemed to a sizeable group of Christians, ministers and clergy that spirits had become, as stated in 1 Corinthians 10:21, the drink of the devil and should be entirely shunned by any serious Christian. However, the mainstream Christian view of wine has always been that it may be consumed in moderation. Many thanks for your attention. I look forward to our discussion.
Ich bedanke mich für die beiden sehr interessanten Vorträge, die sicher viele neue Fragen aufwerfen. Bevor wir zum dialogischen Teil übergehen, möchte ich jetzt auch die Zuschauer noch einmal dazu einladen, ihre Fragen an unsere heutigen Referenten zu stellen. Dafür können Sie entweder direkt den Link auf unserer Homepage zu dieser Veranstaltung anklicken oder auf Slido gehen. Die Adresse und das Eventcode werden gerade eingeblendet. Aber nun zurück zu unseren Referenten. Professor Rosenblum, Wein wird auch heutzutage von verschiedenen religiösen Gemeinschaften, zum Beispiel Christen, für gottesdienstliche Zwecke gebraucht. Die Vorstellung jedoch, dass der Wein, wenn nicht bewacht, von Nichtjuden sofort für rituelle Zwecke missbraucht wird, wirkt realitätsfern.
The idea that wine, when not guarded, is immediately misused or abused, even by non-Jews, might be considered unrealistic. Spontaneous libation does not exist in either the Western or Muslim worlds, for neither Christians nor Muslims perform libations. Are there any voices in Orthodox Judaism today asking to reconsider the halakha as far as this question is concerned? And, Professor Rosenblum, do you know where Reformed Jewish communities such as Masorti stand on this issue?
Thank you. Yeah. So, in my talk, I focused on the ancient world, so stopping in the 6th century, 7th century of the Common Era. There, I'm happy to talk about beyond that, which is what your question gets to. And in fact, this is an interesting dilemma. Medieval Jewish commentators note that that was talking about Greek and Roman practices. They acknowledge that officially, at least, and the vast majority of Muslims do not drink wine, right? So there would be no concern for them to libate wine if they're not even going to drink it, and it would be anathema to tenets of Islam. And most medieval Jewish authorities are even willing to admit that it's a very large stretch to claim that Christian practice is anything like what the Mishnah and Talmud is imagining for libations to other deities. So David's talk was very much about a very different type of practice than the rabbis are talking about that. But what you get into there and then past that is the question of to what extent the rules should continue out of a broader concern. And that tension exists, continues. So one strategy around that is just to say, you know what, if all kosher wine is boiled, you just never have to worry about who handles that, whether it's left alone and such. So out of an abundance of caution, just do that. And that becomes one strategy. You asked about Reformed Jews. Most Reformed Jews would say, well, that was an artifact of the past that is no longer a concern today, so wine does not need that. Conservative Jews are, it's a little more complex. Some will have that opinion. Some would prefer to have either wine that is under kosher supervision or wine that is boiled wine for those similar reasons. So it's a variety of possibilities in that. But again, I've focused on the ancient, but I'm happy to continue talking about the modern time. So does that answer your question, Shoni?
Ja, das hört sich auf jeden Fall sehr sinnvoll an.
Thank you very much. Makes sense to me.
Ich guck noch mal auf Slido, ob es irgendwelche Fragen gibt. Noch
I'm taking a look at Slido, whether we have questions from the audience. But so far, no, we don't have any Slido questions. But Professor Grummet, I have a question for you. And because Professor Rosenberg has cited texts discussing the possibility of replacing wine with local beverages, so have similar questions been discussed with by Christian theologians as well? Because after all, wine is a foreign beverage in many regions of the world and often difficult to obtain, too.
Yes, there certainly has been. I mentioned in my talk using non-fermented grape juice. If we look back to early Christian practice, it seems that milk was used in a few Eucharists, but this was quite quickly viewed as as unorthodox, and so doing this or offering other foods in place of the bread as well, or in addition, was seen as heterodox. I guess similar questions arise much later as Christianity spreads globally to regions where, as you say, that there is not wine. People might make say a strong drink out of fermenting dates, for example. Can they be used instead? The question was sometimes asked in missionary contexts. I guess in practice, sometimes, say, date wine was used, other times not. I suppose in Christian tradition, the use of the wine for the Eucharist has just become so deeply ingrained and rooted in Scripture that it seems difficult to envisage sort of replacing that with another beverage as the norm. However, if you're in a context where you simply cannot obtain wine, then I guess it's arguably better to use the other beverage than not use anything at all.
Okay. Professor Rosenblum.
Thank you. Professor Rosenblum, Jews need wine for a kiddush, for example, on Friday night. And Jews in Europe, however, were rarely allowed to own farms, vineyards, or land in the past. So how did they make or buy kosher wine in Europe? And what was the situation like in Muslim countries? Has there always been a smooth supply of kosher wine? And what happened in those communities where there was no local wine or where they couldn't afford any?
So the answer to that actually will connect to the last slide in Professor Grummet's talk about the Christian temperance movement. So what evidence suggests is that just because there are official rules preventing people from doing things does not mean that the social reality of that was. I always say to my students, right, that I write on the syllabus the official rules, but in 1,000 years, a historian couldn't predict that that's exactly how the class went, that everyone handed in their paper on time because it was due on September 15th, right? And so what we have is that communities had ways of growing grapes or getting access to wine that they controlled the production of. There also is evidence that if they couldn't, they would find other ways of getting something. For example, I highlight the tension with beer in a certain region. But particularly in Europe, you see evidence of Jews being involved in the production of wine. And then that leads, there's a book, I'm blanking on the name of the author, but it's called Yonkel's Tavern, that talks about Jews in the liquor trade in Poland and Germany in early modernity, often because there was it was an in-between niche where they could run the tavern and kind of fall in between the cracks, where it was being they were not allowed necessarily to profit from it, but they became middlemen in that trade. And it's an interesting history that I can't kind of get too into right now, but just to say there always were kind of in between the cracks ways for this to happen. And that continues in America, where Jews emigrate to the New York area. And then they, because of the need for wine, they start to grow their own grapes, and particularly Concord grapes grow well there, which creates a very sweet wine, which is why kosher wine, particularly in America and beyond, gets often associated in modernity with very sweet wine, like Manischewitz wine. And the Christian temperance movement, when it was looking for grapes, like the Welch's family, which is famous for then Welch's grape juice, which started as a Christian temperance non-wine beverage, ended up buying a lot of grapes from Jews who were growing Concord grapes for their sacramental wine. So it's an interesting moment of Jews were growing the grapes to have clearly fermented wine, and Christian temperance movement was buying that grape to have purposely not fermented wine.
Okay, ich habe jetzt auch hier schon zwei Fragen von unseren Zuschauern.
So, I do have two questions from our viewers.
Ich lese mal beide Fragen vor, weil sie sich irgendwo auch ähnlich sind.
Let me read out these questions. Is there an association between wine and blood? And does that explain the complex handling of wine in Judaism? Second question. In Christianity, okay, association, wine equals blood. Is that what we can say about Christianity as well? So is there this similarity, a commonality? And of course, the two religions handle wine very carefully, and maybe that reason for this being that this is associated with blood. Okay, Professor Grammett. You go first, please.
Thank you. Yes, there's something in that. Clearly, in Christian tradition, as I've already said, the Eucharist is so central, according to multiple interpretations. But nevertheless, this red liquid, the blood, and the wine, they just look the same, don't they? But I'd approach this from another direction too. And this sort of draws on sort of classical understandings of fermentation. If one looks back to classical Greek gods associated with wine, principally Dionysius, the reason there was the sort of god activity around wine, it seems to me, is that the process of fermentation wasn't properly understood. So how could this relatively innocuous sort of grape juice that I could drink as much of as I wanted, or that it would cause me to do would be pee, how, when something was done to that, could it become something that inebriated me and made me sort of eventually incapable of doing much at all and having odd dreams and all the rest. So the fact that there could be such a potent transformation from the grape juice into the wine was associated with divine activity, similarly to how the rising of bread had the activity of the gods associated with it too. So in the case of the Christian Eucharist, both the bread and the wine, the sort of theological transformations they were believed to undergo in liturgical use actually mirrored an ancient pre-Christian sort of understanding of the material transformations they went through during the manufacture process. To me, wine is a naturally powerful, sort of potent and suggestive substance. Quite apart from the issue of the colour, what better liquid could be used to signify the lifeblood that courses through humans and other sentient beings?
And to answer the question about the connection with blood and wine, it would be a stretch. There are some times where there's blood becomes wine and blood, they're metaphors, but really there was concern more for the concern of dealing with it more has to do with concern of potential interactions with idolatry. It might look similar, but I wouldn't connect them so closely as I would in, as Professor Grammett was saying, in Christian tradition.
Ich verstehe. Ich habe hier eine weitere Frage auf Slido.
So there is another question via Slido. In Christian context, Sometimes wine is not being used in the Christian context in order to deal in an appropriate manner with addicts. So what about Judaism? Are there similar considerations there? But let me add to this, says the moderator, because children normally get grape juice instead of wine. So what is more important with Kiddush wine? It's the fact that it is an alcoholic beverage or that it is made from grapes? And then what is the rationale behind that?
So you always, when answering a legal question, you always have to look at the totality of the information. So let's separate those out. At first, if you're talking about someone who has an alcohol addiction, that there's real concern for life and health. And there would be, in the vast majority of interpretations, but you always have to leave yourself a little room for one community, present or past, that disagrees with that. But speaking for more broadly, there would be no problem using unfermented grape juice for that, because you can still say it's fruit of the vine in that sense, and you can, and that would work for that in that context. It's not necessarily preferable for every encounter, but given that context, that would still work. And the same thing with children. Now, in some communities, they will allow your child to take a tiny sip, because one tiny sip doesn't matter, of wine, and others they will not. So there's a variety of that, but the preference in vast majority of communities would be to have fermented grape juice or wine. But if there's a strong reason why, whether someone's taking medicine, someone has an addiction concern, someone is a minor, that a unfermented grape juice could certainly fulfill the ritual obligation without any concern like the beer debate was.
So I understand from your answer that the grape per se is more important than the alcoholic content of the liquid.
That's what it seems to be, especially. That's why I like to highlight the debate that I showed, where they were really asking about beer, right? And grape wine really seems to hold. And therefore, if it's a product of the grape, that becomes the more important concern.
Das führt mich tatsächlich auch gleich zu der nächsten Slido-Frage, die uns ein Zuschauer hier stellt.
So, that brings me to my next Slido question.
Englisch, das heißt, ich muss sie ins Deutsche übersetzen.
So,
und zwar, ich habe erfahren, dass die französischen Rothschilds die frühen
Zivilisten that the early Rothschilds actually supported the early Zionists when cultivating wine. Could it be the case that the grape, as it is, being more important than the alcoholic contents, but you know, the connection between the grapes per se and the juice, that's the contents of the question, and the question was a Slido question in English translated into German and back into English.
Okay, so it's a question. This feels very normal for me, a question written in English, translated to German, translated back to English. You're working on ancient texts, we're used to this. What I would say is that, and this is something that comes out, probably came up more in Professor Gremmet's lecture, is the idea of wine and grapes become invested with a lot of meaning. And since you mentioned Zionists, I'd say, I thought Dave made a great point about monasteries' interactions with vineyards and wine, shaping the land and shaping the landscape, and showing, right, those clusters of grape in the biblical stories. So when you're talking about Zionists, right, they're trying to draw connections from biblical texts and to modernity. And wine is a metaphor for that, right? And the idea being that grapes grown in the land, and in the land of Israel with its direct connections, then there it's an agricultural act that's a theological act making a particular historical claim. And the thing that I find fascinating about studying food, and particularly today we're talking about alcohol, but beverages more broadly, and this came out in both of our talks, is that it serves as a metaphor for a variety of interactions with theology and history over a span of 3,000 years. So hopefully that addresses that question, but I think that powerful metaphor is what's being dug into the land, literally and figuratively.
Hier kommt eine Frage auf Slido an.
So another question now to Mr. Grummet. So wine was diluted in the medieval ages, as far as I know, in Christianity. Is that also being done in Christianity for the Eucharist?
Yes, though I want to qualify that by saying it's a difference in liturgical use between adding water to wine and diluting the wine. Now, what do I mean by this, and why do I say it? Well, there are different interpretations of what the water and wine represent when they're brought together, but a common one is that the wine represents Christ's divinity and the water represents Christ's humanity. Now, there are a range of ways of understanding theologically the relationship between Christ's humanity and divinity, but an important aspect of orthodoxy is that Christ's divinity is not lost in the when that is brought together with Christ's humanity. So if the water represents the humanity going into the divinity, classically, when the chalice is filled at the offertory, only a drop of water will be added to the wine. One shouldn't add so much that one can actually taste that the wine is diluted, because symbolically that would suggest that something of Christ's divinity is lost when Christ takes on human form. Rather, what Christian theology says is that Christ's divinity is really fully preserved with Christ's humanity.
Ich habe eine Frage an Professor Rosenblum, und zwar
I have another question directed to Professor Rosenblum. So, Passover celebrated over 8 days and very often takes a long time, you know, during the night, you're still celebrating, and it starts with Seder evening, where 4 glasses of wine must be drunk by all, and a 5th glass is kept on hand in case the prophet Elijah might visit. So maybe you can tell us a little bit more about the Passover and then the many wine drinking ceremonies on Seder night.
So thank you. The Passover Seder is perhaps the most famous instance of rabbinic binge drinking, really, because it involves 4 glasses. And for the rabbis, to connect to something Professor Grummet was just saying, it was a common practice to not to water down wine. And so they believed 1 full glass of wine, undiluted, was over drinking. And four watered-down ones were equivalent to one, because that was the mixture they liked. And this is a broader Greek and Roman custom. Someone in Greek who drank their wine akratos, so not diluted, was considered very uncouth and a drunkard. And it was seen as a big insult, because proper people drank their wine diluted. The Passover Seder comes by the rabbis to be a symbol of the biblical ritual, right? They're living post destruction of the Second Temple. So the Second Temple is destroyed in 70 CE. And the rabbis are trying to figure out how to translate a biblical sacrificial temple-based religion into a world without a temple. And there was a tradition of a home-based Passover celebration, and the rabbis robustly expand on it. And one of the ways that they do that is to draw on Greek and Roman customs of a meal that involves drinking of wine, a long philosophical discussion. And so they over time develop this Seder, and it does involve four glasses of wine and a fifth for Elijah. By the way, they also acknowledge you could have more wine in between. So it's a moment where they're usually very temperance-based in terms of not complete abstention, but we're talking about like one glass of wine for Kiddush, one glass of wine for Havdalah. So this is a bigger drinking moment, but it's also seen as a celebratory moment. And all of this gets mapped onto ideas of freedom from slavery and the enjoyment of being wealthy for a moment. And so it's also an aspirational meal. It's a moment where the groups participating are supposed to connect to ancestral history and say, at this moment, no matter how poor you are or how wealthy you are, you get to eat and drink like a wealthy, free person. So does that get, I could keep going, but does that get to the question you're asking?
Yes. So let's stay with the Passover festivities. Professor Grommet, now I have a very long question for you from my colleagues, Madame Novak. And I'll read it out. So you talked about the traditional Christian idea that the roots of the Eucharist can be found in Passover meal. So at Easter Vigil, Christians sing Hex und in im Festa Pascalia. This is the holy feast of Easter. However, the view that Jesus celebrated Passover Seder with his disciples the night before his death has not gone unchallenged in the Gospels. In the Gospel, according to St. John, the Last Supper was not a Passover meal, but Jesus died at the hour when the Passover lambs were slaughtered for the celebration that would follow. St. Paul also identifies links Jesus directly to the slaughtered animal when he says, get rid of the old yeast so that you may be a new unleavened batch as you really are. For Christ, our Passover lamb has been sacrificed. This is 1 Corinthians 5:7. According to St. John, then the Last Supper was an ordinary meal, not a Pesach meal. How have Christian commentators attempted to bridge this apparent contradiction? And based on this gospel, can we infer the celebration of the Eucharist has had a different origin? And what would that really mean for the Christian view on the Eucharist?
Thank you very much. That's a great question. And I do, in fact, go into this a little bit in my book, Theology on the Menu, written with Rachel Muirs. So we're clearly still in the orbit of Passover, but as the questioner rightly indicated, in John's Gospel, Jesus is crucified as the Passover lamb on that day, rather than eating the Last Supper on that day. So I would say, if we're thinking about wine and blood, this in some ways identifies at least as powerfully, although differently, wine and potentially the wine used in the Passover meal with the blood of Jesus shed on the cross. It is identified with directly with the blood that is shed, rather than with the blood that in the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark and Luke, which talk about the meal on Passover day, they identify it indirectly with the blood. There's sort of the wine here, and then there's the blood that will be shed tomorrow. But in John's gospel, we've got potentially this more direct association between wine and blood. And as the questioner surely knows, if one reads John's passion account, there are a series of details that emphasize that this is taking place on the day of Passover. And one might even think of sort of Jesus as offering sort of the perfect animal sacrifice, if one wants to situate this within a temple tradition, and acknowledging that there's a sense in which the same blood is shared by all sentient beings. There was a point at the end of the question about Eucharistic origins. Although for the purposes of this talk, I've majored on the origins of the Christian Eucharist in the Passover, I'd also want to make a case, as I do in indeed in my book Material Eucharist, that the temple origins of Christian liturgical practice are also important, particularly in the East. It seems to me that sort of liturgical practice develops so rapidly that it would be difficult to maintain that it isn't influenced by temple practice as well as by Passover ritual. So that connects it with wine offerings, and in one place with strong drink offering in a different way too.
Und hier kommt auch schon eine weitere Slido-Frage direkt an
Professor. We have another Slido question to Professor Grummet.
Das Christentum kennt zahlreiche Regeln.
So Christianity also has a lot of rules in terms of how to handle sacramental wine.
Für die Eucharistiefeier benutzt werden.
So what is it that is usable and can be used for the celebration of the Eucharist then?
Thank you. There are no particular rules about what kind of wine can or can't be used. And in different cultures at different times, including today in different parts of the world, there are tendencies towards using different kinds of wine. Obviously, a deep red wine is more visually identifiable with Christ's blood and may also keep better. There's a practical issue that if you're in a church where a whole bottle of wine isn't used in one Eucharist, which is likely to be the case even on a Sunday, if it's a very, very big church, the wine needs to keep. So fortified wine may be used for that reason. I worked as pastoral assistant at a church in France, an Anglican church, and white wine was used there, and that was perfectly acceptable. It was the tradition of the church, but a problem with that was that it went bitter more quickly. I remember one woman saying, when we switched to the red wine, actually that she lost something from the bitter taste of the wine, which to her was important because it brought into her mind and into her prayers something of the sort of bitterness of Christ's suffering and death. But the short answer is no. Any kind of wine can be used, providing according to sort of classic views, at least, that it is alcoholic. But perhaps a coda there. We should draw a distinction between offering the wine and consuming the wine. Alcoholic wine may be offered at the altar, but it doesn't mean that everybody has to consume that. There's a long-standing tradition of people being at communion without receiving either element. If for reasons of addiction, for example, someone doesn't want to receive the wine, they're under no obligation to do so. And as I was suggesting in my talk, in denominations with a strongly developed doctrine of Christ's presence in the elements, if someone has received the bread, it would seem that they've received everything they need to.
Professor Rosenblum, Sie haben gesagt,
thank you. Professor Rosenblum, over to you again, because you said that wine was poured out as libation by a non-Jew, and that was forbidden. Now, the wine that belongs to a non-Jew is Stam Jenam, but you also mentioned Yain Mevushal, cooked wine. So maybe that's a German question now. On our Christmas markets, we get Glühwein, as we say, so cooked wine, yeah, with spices, etc., red wine with spices. Is that kosher wine then?
Yes, sorry. The thing disappeared from my screen. I don't know what happened. But yes, so is cook wine cook? Could you please repeat the question, just because I was frantically trying to figure out what happened.
Yes, no problem. Very simply. Yain Mevushal, cooked wine. So it was cooked and made kosher. So does that mean, as an Orthodox Jew in Germany, when you go to a Christmas market and you get cooked wine, red wine with spices, the Orthodox Jew can drink it?
No. So imagine the cooking process as the pause button on a remote control. And what it does is it pauses it and locks it in at the status that it was at that moment. So if you're going to get cooked spice wine, if that wine hasn't been produced, controlled and handled by a rabbinic Jew, then you've paused it in that status that would be considered not kosher. But the idea about Yain Mevushal is that moment of cooking pauses it in a status where it has been handled by and properly by a rabbinic Jew, and therefore it doesn't matter afterwards, because if the concern was idolatry, this is kind of tricky because medieval rabbinic commentators even note something that historians would note, which is if you go and look at Greek and Roman texts, there's no Greek and Roman text that anyone's ever found that says, hey, fellow idolaters, if you boil wine, it's not usable for pouring out a libation to Dionysus, for example. But it becomes a rabbinic accommodation. And so it becomes less about the reality of that and more about the social situations that creates. And that's one of the things I argue a lot in my scholarship is kashrut, the kosher laws, are about much more than just simply the actual realities of things. It's also about creating certain social situations that are perceived to be desirable or less desirable, right? And so there's so many other things that go into what makes something kosher or not kosher.
Ich habe hier eine Frage an Professor Grummet.
I have a question for Professor Grummet.
Und zwar eine Zuschauerin oder Zuschauer fragt.
A viewer asks the following question.
Moment, ich muss es gerade auch.
But let me read it first myself.
Wie wird der Wein hergestellt?
How is wine being produced and kept? Actually, we talked about that. And when, at what point in time, actually, is the wine transformed into blood? And what type of prayer or words do you have to speak for the transformation to take place?
Thank you. Well, the Christian Eucharist or Mass or Lord's Supper, depending on your denomination
Christliche
and the term,
Eucharistie oder das Abendmahl.
This is where the transformation is believed to happen. There are different prayers in different denominations, but essentially it's at the so-called dominical words. These are words that the priest or presbyter says that repeat the words of Christ that are said at the Last Supper. So first the bread is consecrated, then the wine is consecrated. Of course, not all denominations believe that there is this change happening, but for those that do, it's at these dominical words during the Eucharistic prayer that the change is believed to happen.
Professor Rosenblum, wie wird der koschere Wein heute hergestellt?
So,
Regeln gibt es in
how is kosher wine produced today? And we would also like to know what are the rules regarding the participation of non-Jews in the production process. Can kosher wine be produced by non-Jews at all? And if a non-Jew, as you said, makes the wine unfit for use only by touching the bottle, may only Jewish waiters be hired in Jewish restaurants?
So that's a great question. I'm actually going to start at that last question because it's one of my favorite examples I use for students in class, is that this is where boiled wine really matters, right? Because if you don't have boiled wine and you have a non-Jewish waiter pouring wine, everything that went up to that moment doesn't invalidate the wine. But for many interpretations today, and again, I'm always going to leave wiggle room because I'm not going to say that I am representing the totality of Jewish interpretations on things. Many would have concern for that moment, but if it's boiled wine, there's no more worried because that the pause button has been hit and it stays in that status. So the waiter, it doesn't matter who the waiter is at that moment for regardless of one's interpretation. So now let's go back to the beginning question. There's a variety of ways that wines are prepared, but if we're looking at, I'm going to try and be less of an academic, so I'll say, let's just look at the ways that the major Orthodox kosher certifying agencies would want things to be done. So the production of grapes is supervised by certain rabbinically trained authorities, but supervised by Jews. There can be non-Jews involved in the growing process, but there needs to be, as I mentioned in my talk, a supervision of this process. When it gets time for the actual production, there are certain parts of it that require more active Jewish participation. because the moments designed as transformational, similar to when Professor Grummet was talking about the words recited for any act of Eucharist, right? I could say the exact right words, but because I am neither Christian nor ordained, they would have no effect, right? And so the idea being that at certain key moments, if someone isn't Jewish, that would it would either make it continue to be in a kosher status if they are Jewish, or not be in a kosher status if they aren't. And then in the production of it, most of the time now, a lot of wine becomes Yayin Mevushal just because it makes it so much easier down the road. And so there's a lot in communities that want kosher wine, there often is a preference for that because it makes things more convenient. But if you look at the back of kosher wine bottles, they will let you know if it is or isn't. And the those that aren't, the concerns of handling it for many communities will continue on after that. It would have to get much more technical to get into exactly how that's done, but all along the way, there are moments that there needs to be Jewish supervision. And once it's boiled, though, that need goes away. So I'm happy to answer more technical questions for that, but hopefully that gives enough of the broad outline.
Yes.
Have you booked for lunch tomorrow, or would you like me to do it?
Sie haben jetzt das wunderbar von den ganzen
Produktionsprozess beschrieben. You natürlich interessiert die Menschen auch did tell us about the production process, but of course, you know, the consumption of wine is also of interest to our viewers. And earlier on, you said that consumption of alcohol, beer, for example.
Sagen wir jetzt als Beispiel. In einer nicht-jüdischen Kneipe soll
in a non-Jewish pub,
kein Bier trinken, weil die Gefahr
then Jews should actually not drink beer in that non-Jewish pub because of, you know, these mixed intermarriage situations, etc.
But
non-Jews are invited to Jewish pubs.
Kneipe oder in der jüdischen Bar trinken.
And then drink in the Jewish pub. Well, isn't there the danger of intermarriage occurring?
So there's a few things here that are really interesting. Number one, the rhetoric of control is different. And this is to do with all matters of kosher laws, food and beverage. If it's in a Jewish home or a Jewish establishment under Jewish supervision, then the rules are a little different. And you can see how that controls social interactions, right? Of if you only invite someone to your home but will not go into theirs, right? It sets up a social barrier. The rules for that, as much as that in that text that I quoted says that, they get a little more complicated. You find this with other beverages, like there's a book Robert Liberlis wrote about called Jews Welcome Coffee, about German Jews. And when coffee comes to Germany, and Jews wanting to go to non-Jewish coffee houses and drink coffee. And these sorts of questions come in too. To what extent should social interactions be part of whether the food or beverage is considered kosher. And nowadays, it gets a little more complicated because some Orthodox Jews might be willing to drink with non-Jews beer produced by non-Jews in a non-Jewish tavern, but they might have questions about the kosher status of the tavern. So it gets a little more complicated for that. But these rules, again, the thing I want to remind everyone is that I was talking about ancient texts, and that it gets messy as you start to look more into the lived realities of this, because we have more texts of people complaining that people aren't following the rules than we do about texts of the rules, right? I'm sure Professor Grummet can talk about too, about how many of the early church councils are about complaints of people. John Chrysostom, right, writes all these letters complaining that no one's listening to him. So the realities, it's also one of the reasons I love studying food. The realities of that are people make mistakes in the kitchen. People want to eat together. People want to drink together. And the ways that they interact with that, the ways they try and find ways to comply, but also live the way that they wish to live, make things difficult for me to give you a simple yes or no answer.
Okay.
Okay. Another question from our viewers, because obviously they're very concerned that Jesus, can be transformed by way of these, from wine into blood. And so this is why the forms are of interest. So we are talking about transformation, and how can we actually understand, this transformation in the celebration of the Eucharist, if Jesus is not only symbolically but really present in the wine and bread?
Well, there are a range of theories that have been developed to understand this. In traditions that have quite a high theology of this, that would want to say that Jesus is substantially present in some sense. It's not being said in any way that when the wine is drunk, Jesus' actual blood is being drunk. I mean, Jesus' actual blood was shed at a past historical point in time, and for people who believe that Jesus is now resurrected in heaven in some kind of bodily form, his blood is there with him as part of his flesh. So this isn't cannibalism, but indeed it's important to emphasise that what's sometimes called in Eucharistic theology the accidents, that's the appearance of the wine, through its flavour, its liquidiness, its smell, they all continue. So it doesn't sort of start smelling or tasting like blood. So in terms of our senses and what it is, it is still wine, but it's the substance of the element that's believed to change. So what Christian theologians mean by this is something like sort of what holds it together, what its essence is, becomes Christ-like.
Professor Grummet, wenn Juden über Eucharistie denken, denken Sie
Professor Grummet, when Jews think of the Eucharist, they often recall the numerous trials of host desecration, which took place between the 13th and 16th century, and in which mainly Jews were accused of misusing consecrated hosts. Actually, in Berlin, this happened too in a trial of 1510, where 39 Jews were convicted and burned. And as a result, all the Jews were expelled from this area, Mark of Brandenburg. And so how can we explain the origin of this idea, and why was it so extremely popular?
The idea of host desecration, well, that there is clearly a terrible history of Christian persecution of Jews in many parts of Europe through history. I suppose part of the sort of religious and social dynamic was that if there was something that represented sort of Christian belief and practice and something that ordinary people connected with, it would be likely that people wishing to persecute another group unacceptably would make claims that things sort of central to their faith had been stolen or misused or mishandled in some way by the other group. It's worth saying that there were wide beliefs in the later medieval period of the power of the consecrated host to make physical impacts on its surroundings. So it was being taken out of churches by Christians often, whether it was for fertilizing crops or protecting against fire or storm or flood. There were all kinds of apotropaic uses of the host that most people would now regard as superstitious. So Christians were taking the host out of church sometimes with the greater or lesser approval of clergy. So it's not the fact that either it's only Jews who are doing this or Jews were doing it at all. I think it's part of a much wider concern with the sort of the holiness of something and then really using that as a basis for persecuting another group of people.
Ja, wir bleiben auch bei dem Thema. Hier kommt eine Frage.
So we stay with that subject, and there is a question to our two guests, again from my colleague, Madame Novak. Judaism seems to be driven by the concern that non-Jews would abuse Jewish wine for their religious and thus idolatrous purposes. Christianity is or was driven by a similar obsession. The non-Christians, and historically speaking, mostly Jews, would abuse the sacred wafers. So is that something that to have in common? That is, that which is sacred or most valuable in each case must be protected specifically because others could seize it. So that which is sacred to me as a Jew or a Christian will inevitably arouse the desires of the others?
What I would say to that, and I'm sure we'll both have our answers, is if you look at the history of these, what you often find is people talking about the other rather than dialoguing with the other. So, for example, the scholar Magda Teeter, who just published a book on the blood libel and how many of those are just people repeating the same story over and over again. It's not, and most of that is not actual, you know, going out and actually talking to other people about, right? The standard line, right, is that the Hebrew Bible forbids the consumption of blood. So really, if this is blood, right, then a Jew ingesting it would be violating Judaism. And the rabbinic accounts of the compulsive libationers that I talked about, aren't borne out by reading Greek and Roman texts. And so what I take from that is that these are historical examples of what happens when humans don't actually talk to each other. They just talk about each other. But I don't know what, Professor Gilman, your take on this is.
Yes, this matter of protection is interesting and important. I think what I would add is that from whom are the elements being protected? And I would say particularly the host, the bread, because that was easier to preserve and distribute sometime after the Eucharist. The a reservation or preservation for a period of days or weeks of wine is much less common in Christian practice because of the difficulties of doing that. There were concerns by the 12th, early 13th centuries that Christians were misusing hosts. I referred to a series of sort of apotropaic uses, sort of things like fertilizer, putting out fires, protecting vineyards from disease. So in 1215, it was decreed that the host should be kept under lock and key. Now, as I say, this was the host, the bread rather than the wine, but this was actually part of a movement where the elements were being protected even from Christian lay people. So forget about protecting them from Jews. This was protecting them from ordinary Christians and keeping them really as the preserve of clergy. So it made it harder, for instance, for them to be taken to the dying in time if they were locked away and only a priest had access to them. So yeah, there are different dimensions of protection from sort of people of other religions, but protection even from the majority of people within the religion as part, I think, of a process of sort of disciplining and concentrating more power on the ordained hierarchy. And it's around this time, interestingly, that a strong theology of Christ's presence in the bread and the wine really develops. So there are theological and sort of liturgical and sort of power-based factors to this all coming together.
Professor Rosenblum, die Vorstellung von Jain Nesek.
Professor Rosenblum, the ideas of Jain Nesek and Jain Stam have their roots, as you said, in pagan antiquity when libations were common. But other foods were also used in non-Jewish ritual contexts, such as oil. So were there similar concerns and restrictions regarding the production and consumption of, let's say, oil?
Yeah, so, well, yes and no. So we'll start with that. So in terms of idolatry, really wine is the main food item that is discussed. But in terms of to what extent food produced by non-Jews would have certain concerns attached to it, oil is one of the big ones. And oil, it's a rather interesting case because there's no food issues with oil in the Hebrew Bible. But then in Second Temple period texts, we start to find some texts that start talking about Jewish oil. And what that precisely is complicated. And even, for example, you have texts that Josephus talks about someone who basically sets up a monopoly for himself to corner the market on Jewish olive oil so that Jews could only buy olive oil from him. But we have no text that says that olive oil must be produced by Jews. That starts in the Mishnah, the first rabbinic document edited around 200 CE. And what interestingly happens, it's the same tractate, Avodah Zarah, idolatry, that I've been talking about for these idolatrous texts. And they talk about wine, bread, and oil. And when they talk about wine, they have all these idolatrous concerns. When they talk about olive oil, first they say, well, yes, there's this concern, but you know what? Forget it. And what that seems to be is there were concerns about monopolies and the way and olive oil production being too controlled for that. And same thing with bread, there's concerns, but bread is actually a really interesting comparison because what they kind of come down on it is if there's a Jewish bakery in town, you should only buy from the Jewish bakery. If there's no Jewish bakery in town, you can buy bread from a non-Jewish bakery because there's not concern for idolatry. And I just can't resist telling one of my favorite tales. There's this character named Ivru who lives in a town where there's a Jewish bakery and kind of walks out of town until he crosses the boundary into the next town where there's no Jewish bakery, and he buys bread there. Because then technically he hasn't violated the rule because he can buy it there, but he went out of his way to do it. And the text is not so happy with him. But there you're starting again to see the social accommodation for things. So wine gets the most invested with concerns for idolatry, and the rest have a variety of other concerns attached to them.
Okay. Also ich habe hier eine Frage auf Slido.
So I received another Slido question, but
ich hebe sie noch etwas auf.
No, I'll keep it for later.
Eine schöne Frage, aber ich hebe sie
nice
auf.
Question, also müssen, but I'll keep it for later. So sorry. Dear viewers, you will receive the question later on, but not
sie
quite yet. Okay,
erklärt,
I have another question for Professor Grummet before that one. Because you stated that in the medieval ages there was a debate between the Franciscan and Dominican monks regarding the status of the blood of Christ. And you said that the Dominicans see the blood of Christ as part of his humanity. And the Franciscan monks, on the other hand, say that the shed blood of Christ remained in the world of nature and thus symbolizes the, well, transience of life on earth, that is death, so has a negative connotation. And so this also means that the chalice basically represents what is not there rather than what is there, namely the presence of Christ. And so is this Franciscan theology maybe the reason why it is rare in the Catholic Church to give communion in both forms, bread and wine? And what about other Christian denominations?
That is a good hunch, and I've wondered this in the past. I think, unfortunately, that's probably not the reason that the chalice is often withheld in Roman Catholic churches. Essentially, the Dominican theology, of which Thomas Aquinas was the supreme exponent, came to dominate over Franciscan theology in the Roman Catholic Church. And it's probably only relatively recently that some important aspects of Franciscan theology have been recovered, most recently in connection with environmentalism. I think the tradition of withholding the chalice in Roman Catholic contexts is more to do with the difficulty of administering the wine in ways that aren't potentially causing it to be spilled. If you have a high theology of Christ's presence in the bread and wine, you want to do everything you can to avoid anything being lost, but even just a few crumbs of bread or a few drops of wine. I think this is probably the reason, and we need to remember that in Roman Catholic churches, it's actually only relatively recently that it's been the norm for lay people to receive even the host, even the bread, on a regular basis. Before the Second Vatican Council, it was very common indeed for believers to attend Mass but make a spiritual communion, that is, pray, rather than actually receiving even just the bread, let alone the wine. So there is this tradition of people not receiving. I think I would argue now that it's been accepted that people should regularly receive the host, that is the bread. They should also be able to receive the chalice with the wine in it too.
habe hier eine weitere Slido-Frage an Professor Grummet.
Another question to Professor Grummet. Okay, you showed a picture based on Jesaja 63, it said, but in 63 it said, well, it's revenge, about revenge and the punishment. So the pictures that you showed, did they have something to do with revenge or punishment?
Yes, there are these two different traditions around Christ in the wine press. And I tried to cover this, albeit briefly, in the presentation. One is, yes, that the grapes are being trodden wrathfully, and there is an element of some judgment in Christ's crucifixion. We could see Christ on the cross as sort of judging human sin and finding humans wanting. After all, why is Jesus on the cross? It's because human beings have put him there. But on the other hand, there is this aspect of the theology of the crucifixion linked with salvation and Jesus wanting to save people. And so when we look at the cross, there is this aspect of judgment, but also this aspect of salvation, which we ultimately would want to rejoice in. And we know that sort of the use of wine is linked with rejoicing too. So I would see both streams present in this wine press tradition.
Ich komme zu unserer letzten Frage und deshalb habe ich auch
so, I come to my last question.
Gibt es im Christentum oder Judentum
in Christianity or in Judaism, are there any situations where intoxication through alcohol also can have a positive aspect? And I also have a question along these lines. Yes, wine does have an intoxicating effect, but in some natural religions, other substances are also used in order to create spiritual feelings and enhance the emotions. So does that play a role in Christianity and Judaism as well, maybe? Maybe Professor Rosenblum, you start.
That's a lot to say. So we'll start with the second part. So, for example, there are mystical traditions in a variety of religious traditions, including Judaism, like medieval Kabbalah and Jewish mysticism, that did a variety of practices to alter the mind. And that could be fasting for long periods of time, staying up very late, drinking too much, or engaging in the use of other substances to alter one's consciousness, right? And as one scholar of medieval Kabbalah has pointed out, that right, if you do all those things and then think about God, you will have a mystical experience. Now, whether that is the random firings of the synapses of your brain or real connection with divinity, that comes down to what your theological belief is, right? But it's if you get very drunk or stay up for days on end and then try and think about God, you will have some sort of experience. So if we're going to talk about that, we could go in that direction. The majority of rabbinic traditions are about moderation, but there are moments. I mentioned the Seder, but also famously there's the Jewish festival of Purim, which occurs in about March every year. And it is sort of a reenactment of the biblical story of Esther, where Jews were almost slaughtered, but then events happen that lead to a reversal, and it's a rather vicious ending of punishment being met out to the enemies, and it becomes a moment of revelry of Jews celebrating another sense of deliverance. And there becomes a tradition of not only drinking, but drinking to excess. And as I talk about in my book, Rabbinic Drinking, there's interesting that two stories are right next to each other in the Talmud. One is very famous, one is not. And I think that they need to be equally famous. The famous story is that Jews are supposed to drink to excess on the Purim to the point where they do not know the difference between the good guy in the story and the bad guy in the story, between Mordechai, the good guy, and Haman, the bad guy. And that every college student who is in any way connected to Judaism knows that answer and uses that as an excuse to drink to excess. But if you read that exact passage right after it, they tell a story of two friends who decided to hang out on Purim and got drunk, and one slaughtered his friend in the middle of the night, slit him from ear to ear, and then woke up in the morning, realized what he'd done, and prays to God, and a miracle happens, and his friend is brought back to life. So the next year he says to his friends, let's celebrate Purim again. And his friend says, no, right? Because not every year God might perform a miracle. And I say they need to be read together because, there's a tradition of drinking a bit too much on that day. But remember, even when you're drinking too much, you shouldn't drink too much because bad things can happen. I read that as that tension between letting go a little bit, but remembering that you still want your friend alive in the morning.
Vielen Dank, Dr. Rosenblum. Das war übrigens die
thank you very much. That really was the shortest summary that I've ever heard of Ezra. So, but of course, the question also goes to Professor Grammett.
Yes, thank you. I don't have such a long answer as that. Be fair to say that in Christian tradition, moderation is emphasized. This is in scripture and subsequent interpretation, though what moderation may mean differs from one person to another. What I would say, though, is that in some spiritual writings, inebriation is used as an image for when sort of rationality is suspended and other forms of knowledge of God or connection with God are pursued or even attained. So although drunkenness here isn't being praised or necessarily even happening, images of inebriation are being drawn on. Now, I suppose one might ask, well, were the spiritual writers at some times themselves inebriated, or had they just sort of heard reports of this from other people or observed other people? We can't know for sure, but it is interesting that inebriation is at least sometimes used as a positive metaphor for some close connection with God through prayer.
Ja, unsere Veranstaltung geht langsam zu Ende und ich möchte mich bei unseren Gästen für ihre äußerst interessanten.
So, our event is now slowly coming to an end. So I would like to take that opportunity to thank our guests, especially because they gave us some extremely interesting contributions. So thank you very much. And to our viewers, I would like to draw your attention to our next event. This is going to be on relationship to animals in Judaism and Hinduism at in September on 7 o'clock. And so the speakers Well, thank you so much again. And of course, thank you to my museum colleague, Sofia Novak, the scientific advisor to the program, the brain, so to speak, behind this event. So many thanks to our interpreters, Güder Turo, Astrid Gese, cameraman Donna McKay, and the Art Lights technical team, and Stefan von Zwoll from Event Management, and Lechheim at the end of this day.